It's time to explore life in a church divided.
In our last video, we looked at how different groups of Christians hold to very different doctrines about baptism. And today, we're going to look at how they also hold to different doctrines about the Lord's Supper. Now, just like with baptism, practically every Christian agrees that the Lord's Supper is something that Jesus established, and that Jesus wants Christians to keep on celebrating and sharing this meal of bread and wine on a somewhat regular basis. But there are huge differences between Christians about what exactly is going on when we eat the Lord's Supper. And by and large, we can boil all of these differences down into four major views about what's happening when you take communion. The first view holds that there are two big things happening at communion. First, they believe Jesus' body and blood are physically there in the Lord's Supper. They believe that the bread and the wine don't just stay bread and wine, but actually become the body and the blood of Christ. So these Christians believe that when you eat that bit of bread or when you drink that bit of wine, you are actually eating Jesus' own body and drinking Jesus' own blood. The second thing these Christians believe happens at communion is that this body and blood of Jesus are then offered up to God the Father as a sacrifice for sin. And that's a key part of this view. The body and blood of Jesus are being offered to God the Father. And the people receive the benefits of Jesus' sacrifice that's been offered to God when they eat and drink the body and blood of Jesus. So, again, for these Christians, the two big things that happen in the Lord's Supper is first, that the body and blood of Jesus are physically there, and second, that this body and blood is then offered up to God as a sacrifice for our sins. And this is the view that's held by the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church. Now, in the second view, there are also two big things happening at communion. First of all, Christ's body and blood are actually being received by people who take the Lord's Supper. In other words, the body and blood of Jesus are actually given in and with the bread and the wine. So when you eat the bread, you receive Christ's body. When you drink the wine, you receive Christ's blood. The second thing that these Christians believe happens is that Jesus offers his body and blood to you in order to give you the forgiveness and the life and the salvation that he's won for you. So for these Christians, the Lord's Supper is not a sacrifice for sins that's offered up to God. Instead, these Christians hold the Lord's Supper is a gift of forgiveness of sins that is offered to you. And to repeat, in this view, the body and blood of Jesus are physically present in and with the bread and wine, and the body and blood are offered then to you as a gift of grace. And this is the view that's held by Lutheran churches. Now, the third view also holds that two big things are going on in communion. First, they believe that you are receiving a symbol of Christ's presence. So they hold that the bread and the wine that you eat and drink are meant to symbolize that Jesus shares himself spiritually with you when you come to him in faith. But these Christians do not believe that when you eat the bread or the wine, that you're getting the body and blood of Jesus. They do not think that Jesus is physically present in the Lord's Supper. They believe that Jesus shares himself with us through faith, not through bread and wine. So in this view, eating and drinking the bread and wine don't actually give you Jesus. The bread and wine are simply meant to assure you that Jesus does unite himself with you when you believe in him. The second thing that these Christians believe happens is that the Lord's Supper then symbolizes Jesus offering you his grace. In other words, the Lord's Supper serves as an assurance that Jesus will give you grace and forgiveness if you approach him in faith. But the Lord's Supper itself doesn't actually give you forgiveness. It gives you an assurance that Jesus forgives people who come to him in faith. So, to restate, this view holds, first, that the Lord's Supper symbolizes Christ's presence, and second, that it symbolizes Christ's grace. This view is held by Reformed Christians, like Presbyterians and some Baptists. The fourth view is that the Lord's Supper is simply a memorial meal. In other words, it's something Jesus told us to do to help remind us that Jesus died for us on the cross. And in this view, there's only one thing that's really happening at communion. We get a reminder that Jesus died for us on the cross. In this view, Jesus is not present at the Lord's Supper in any particular sense. God doesn't use the Lord's Supper on us in any special way. It's not a sacrifice offered to God. It's not a gift that offers you grace. And it's not even an assurance of what he will do for believers. The supper is simply and only a way to remember what Jesus did on the cross. This view is held by a lot of Baptists and by Pentecostals and a whole lot of non-denominational churches. Now, you might have noticed that there's actually quite a bit of overlap between what Christian groups think of baptism and what they think of the Lord's Supper. Christians who hold that baptism is a means of grace tend to hold that Christ is really present in the Lord's Supper and is doing something there to save us. Christians who view baptism as a symbol of a covenant tend to view the Lord's Supper as more symbolic of Christ's presence and grace. While Christians who view baptism as something we do to confess our faith tend to view the Lord's Supper as something we do to remind ourselves about Jesus. That overlap is very similar to the way different views of sin and salvation overlap. When a Christian group holds one doctrine of sin, it tends to have a huge impact on what that group of Christians holds about salvation. And all that is predictable, because like we said before, doctrines fit together like pieces in a puzzle. Or another way of putting it, doctrines hold together like the main parts of a story. When you put your doctrines together, they tell the grand story of who God is and what he does for us. And if there is a difference in the stories, say, between a Lutheran and a Baptist on one part of their story, say there's a difference about how bad sin is and how it affects our lives, then the chances are very high that there is also going to be a difference in other parts of the story, about baptism, about salvation, about the Lord's Supper. After all, if you change one part of a story, then if you still want that story to make sense, you have to change other parts of the story to make them fit together. So a change in one doctrine virtually guarantees that other doctrines will change too. And if the story changes enough, if there are enough differences, then eventually the God that each of these groups talk about and what he does for us and how we are able to approach him, those stories can start to sound very different. And like we said at the beginning of this series, that can lead people to very different places to put their faith. And we're going to see more of those differences next time when we look at different doctrines of the ministry. That's all for now. We'll see you next time.